Dana, tell me, what's going on in this gorgeous painting?
Well, this is actually part of a triptych. So there's three panels this size, and this is the far right panel. And in the center panel is a tree of life, and it's rooted in the cosmos, and it branches out into infinity, and it represents the center of creation, but also the center of the human being, the spine, and how these two centers overlap. And in this side, we have the forces of creation beginning to build their dynamics, swirling and twirling and interfacing with each other and becoming ever more complex. And as they evolve, as primal forces become more evolved, they become the symbolic realm and the ideational and the mini worlds that we create. And then that comes back to the center. But it can also be read the other way, because this is also, if you think about it, the ideational causal level coming first and beginning to move into energy, and then that energy beginning to swirl into form. So it's about the beginning and end of time. The whole piece is called Autumn in the Garden of Eden. And so it's the time in which the center of creation overflows into form.
It is, it's wonderful to be standing. I mean, I feel like I'm in that energy because you've made it so big. So it's full life size. Welcome to Over the Edge. I'm Janaea Donaldson. I'm the guest host for this version, which is From Edge to Center, Dana Lynn Anderson, visionary cosmic artist. Thank you. Dana is the director of the Academy for Art, Creativity, and Consciousness in Italy, and the founder of the Awakening Arts Network. I think we're going to have a juicy time. Let's find out. I want to know how you got started in this kind of art, Dana.
Well, let's see. I've always been an artist, I have to say. From childhood on, I was always playing with art, creativity, making things, painting, drawing. That was my, those were my toys. But interestingly, it was a long time before I actually became an artist, because I had, like a lot of people in my generation, a real save the world complex. You know, I thought the world is falling apart. It's in a lot of danger. I was very concerned about it from an early age on. When I was even 6 and 8 years old, I was hanging around with people who were college students and involved with that. And so it was in my consciousness early. And I thought, I can't be an artist because that's just so self-indulgent. You know, I just love it and it makes me happy and it's bliss beyond measure. But how could I do that when the world is in trouble?
Particularly when you have a world which only sees art in a very narrow framework, in a consumerist culture that sees it as a product.
Right.
Which we'll get to, I'm sure.
No, that's exactly right. And I think that's probably why it took me a while to really realize that, in fact, with art and creativity, what I came to discover, because I always continued to do it on my own, as I went and got my undergraduate in philosophy and master's degree in consciousness studies, and I thought that I would just, you know, figure it all out and then write the book and then publish it and everybody would know what to do. But, I mean, it's so funny when you think about how you're thinking about things when you're young. But I kept doing the art, and I began to realize, as I also taught other people about the creative process, and I began to realize that really what art is and what it does is so much huger than we have any conception. So just like you're saying, and it awakens us inside, and it actually helps human beings to open up the inner world, to open up the inside of their life. And so in that way, then they get to find their center. And once the center is found, then each person comes into play with what needs to happen to help save the world. It's like we can't save the world from our head.
That's
you know,
true.
Like we're
That's
running
true.
Around going, oh, I've got to do this, and the ice is melting, and this is happening, and we get more and more frazzled and frightened and afraid because we're thinking, what should I do about this? What can I do about it? And I believe that at the center of us, at the center of our creation, of ourselves, is the source. And that is God in action. And that when we come to that place, we're able to know what to do. Because what you're supposed to do is different from what I'm supposed to do. And if you run around trying to do what I'm supposed to do, it doesn't help.
And it doesn't work.
It doesn't work
either. And we feel that. Right.
Yeah.
I mean, I was just thinking about the title here, From Edge to Source. In one sense, in your early life, you did that. You went out, you know, to the edges of thinking to be an activist or an environmentalist or whatever. And then what you're saying is you tap the source in yourself, where the joy is, where the creativity is, where the imagination is. I mean, it feels to me like that lets you be a fuller human being. A lot of us, you're right, running around with our heads, but we're even missing half our brain.
Yeah.
Right?
No, it's exactly right. The right half, as a matter of
the
fact.
The right half. Which is about spatial and music and visual and color and actually the primordial sense of identifying where we are in the environment. Trees, you know, all
yeah,
of that
exactly.
is primal for us. Which takes us back to, of course, what you're creating. So you at some point then you made a shift to mm-hmm. seeing I can do this.
I want to be an artist, yeah. Mm. And I just I began to paint more and more, and I also began to teach more and more. And for me they've always dovetailed and interfaced. And so I have now shown my artwork in different places, mostly centers of consciousness. I haven't gone through the traditional gallery. Routes
Actually,
as much.
While we're talking, I'd love to see, show us some of what you've created, because mm-hmm. I think you and the viewers and I would love to see sort of the part of your journey, at least shown visually. You said that you have mainly done it at centers of consciousness. I want to take us back, because mm-hmm. a degree in philosophy and a degree in consciousness is not your normal average person's education.
Mm-hmm.
What are those like? Consciousness in particular. Where did you study and what was that about?
Well, I went to John F. Kennedy University and I got a master's degree in consciousness studies, which is the degree program. And mm-hmm. it was looking at all of the different models of culture, consciousness, human nature that have existed throughout different time periods and across cultures. And so it's kind of like East-West, but that's very flat.
Can
you know?
give us a couple of examples? What
Well,
different models.
You know, the East and West is a good example because
right.
people are familiar with it, that, you know, that there's a whole different perception of what the nature of reality is and what the human mind is. And so a good example, actually, that's very relevant to the arts is that in the Western culture, we've tended to focus on the conscious mind and the subconscious or the okay. unconscious, like okay. Freud and others, like what's buried underneath the conscious mind.
Okay.
And the East has been understands that there's an unconscious and a subconscious, but the focus is on the superconscious and the understanding that outside that tiny little iceberg, let's look at the model of the iceberg, like the tip of the iceberg, what's sticking out is the conscious mind, and underneath there's this huge ocean of water, and most of the bulk of the iceberg is underneath. But that iceberg is on a planet. And above the planet are the stars, and beyond the stars are the galaxies. And so there's an actually much huger world that's in the superconscious or beyond the conscious mind coming from higher levels.
So you're saying, I mean, really, from the Eastern perspective, the cosmos, the cosmology is sort of primary?
Exactly.
And we're just, you know, the tip in
exactly.
there.
Exactly.
Rather than, you know, the West, it seems like humans have tried to become the center of everything.
Yes.
And don't give a lot of credence, other than some of the religions, yes, indeed, to there being a bigger reality.
Well, and also our current cultural understanding is that matter creates consciousness, that, you know, first there was this little mud ball, and eons of time went by, and it evolved life forms, and then eventually humans evolved, and then eventually they became conscious. And the Eastern philosophy is entirely different, that primary to everything is consciousness, and that consciousness condenses into energy, and that energy, you know, coagulates or constellates into matter. And so what is primary is consciousness, and matter is just the thin surface, the epiphenomenon of consciousness. So it's an entire reversal of that perspective.
Which is what makes this image so interesting, is because you really said we can see it both ways,
mm-hmm.
sort of both worldviews.
Mm-hmm.
Aha. Uh-huh.
Yeah, actually, that's right. It is looking at it those
Coming
two different
ways. Coming from consciousness
into
form and, you know, mm-hmm. into the complexity that happens.
Mm-hmm. And I think, in general, our time period is moving from an understanding of matter as primary to an understanding of at least energy as being what's really more primary. I mean, just an example in the sciences. You know, 100 years ago, we were sitting in solid, hard matter. These chairs, everything around us
right.
was solid, hard matter. And we were looking for the building block, you know, the fundamental...
The atom, the fundamental
block.
Block
right. that's... I mean, block, just that word, you know, the piece of matter that's the hardest, little, tiniest, you know, BB underneath it all. And so, but what happened is we plunged into matter and we found the atom. And the atom, if you blew an atom up to the size of a football field, at the center you would have something maybe like the size of a tomato seed or a grain of salt. And the electron way out there at the edge of the whole football field would be this tiny little grain of salt. So the matter that's involved in the atom is infinitesimal, but what makes it seem solid is that it's swirling and twirling and all that motion, which is energy. The energy and motion makes it seem like hard matter. And then now they go into the electron and the proton and they find there's actually quarks and leptons. And when we go deeper still, what the cutting edge of even traditional science is, string theory, saying that in fact these are actually made out of vibrating squiggles of energy that in fact don't have any matter at all, that are matterless. And so, you know, even science is uncovering the energetic mm-hmm. basis of reality. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, I think that our whole culture is moving from that understanding. So a few hundred years ago, form and matter and also the left brain, the linear and the sequential side of intelligence was predominant. And that's shifting.
And you see that in the arts. I was just reflecting that at about the time of the Impressionists, at the end of the 19th century, they began to break apart solid-seeming matter, at least into dots of light.
Yes, that's true.
And the cubists beginning to take time and planes and show us time. So I think that the arts have reflected the sciences are discovering for us.
Yes, they have. But interestingly,
to some degree.
No, they have. But I'm curious about what's happened as of late, because it seems like at a certain point, the arts aren't really bringing forth the revelation of what's really happening in the cosmological discoveries mm-hmm. of our time. Like mm-hmm. the mm-hmm. arts, the astronomy is in a renaissance of discovering the size of our universe. When my mother and grandmother were in school, we lived in a galaxy. And one day, we might discover another galaxy. That was the model. You know, now we look at we aim the Hubble's telescope at the darkest place of space where it's absolutely black and say, what might we see with this increased vision? And thousands of galaxies are there. I mean, the size of our world has expanded hugely. And somehow, for some reason, the arts, probably because of being usurped commercially and brought into a very flattened mode, as did the rest of our culture, has become very flattened. The arts aren't expressing the wonderment of the expansion of our world or the trials of our time and the important issues. They're, you know, things like dead sharks and vats of formaldehyde and you know, hula hoops made out of barbed wire that caused the woman to bleed and just really kind of grotesque and shocking things. So that's kind of why the idea of the edge and the source, because what's really considered original right now, originality is like the cutting edge. What's on the very periphery? What breaks the rule? What takes you past the boundary that existed before? And what I think is really central to creativity and to originality is the origin. The word originality means from the origin. And so when you come to that source within, that's actually the place that is generative of true creativity, not breaking rules that becomes a game of shock value, mm-hmm. of how mm-hmm. can you become even mm-hmm. more disgusting than last year's entry. This brings forth new worlds when you come to the center, and that's what we need in our time. So I actually think for whatever reason, the arts have not been the vanguard of consciousness as of late. They have become the reflection of the commercial culture, yes. and they've flattened.
Yes, yes. What it seems to me is the arts that you're describing, because of that pressure for novelty, you know, because to titillate the senses,
yes.
like other media,
mm-hmm.
like other experiences, sort of like
yes.
we're consuming them, and after you've had, you know, the shark and the formaldehyde, then you move on to the next one and the next one. But they feel to me like they are often expressions of sort of our hyper-individuality. It's sort of like our Western culture has certainly, mm-hmm. you know, put the individual, the personality level, the individual sort of at the apex of creation.
Yeah. No, that's exactly
and
right.
And that novelty is happening from that art. And it it fails to have sort of some lasting, life-changing effect.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And that's what I believe so strongly, that the arts have tremendous power that has not been tapped in our recent time period. In the ancient time periods, perhaps that was tapped, and that's that the arts can really touch infinity. The arts can reveal what this world of senses doesn't show us. It can reveal realms of being. It can reveal the infinitude within, the eternity, and the power and the generative source from that.
The generative source, which reminds me, there's other images you've done that are focused on that, on the creation. Mm-hmm. I'd like to see some of those, on the creation from that source, you know. That's a very different, I mean, it feels to me like you're coming around to the arts from a different angle.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to know, are there other people doing this? Mm-hmm. Or do you feel like a lone voice out here? And not just in the visual arts, which you obviously but in music, in theater, in film, anything else? Do you see any?
No, absolutely. It's kind of an interesting situation. I think that this has parallels in almost every aspect of society, which is that there is on the surface sort of the powers that be or the given systems that are in place are in defense of the old paradigm. And then there's crabgrass everywhere. Through the sidewalks, cracking, are little green shoots happening all over the place. And so I see artists all over the world beginning to tune into this new energy. And in fact, we can talk about this. There's an Awakening Arts Network, which is part of bringing these artists together. And I want to tell you about that. But just that what happens is the venues of display of art or the venues for concerts and music and dance and theater are still mostly reserved for what is from this old tradition. And so there's new ways of showing work coming through. Like, that's why I was saying I show at centers of consciousness. I have had exhibitions at the Institute of Noetic Sciences or California Institute of Integral Studies, places where people, where those shoots of crabgrass are growing.
Well, and of consciousness, people paying attention to consciousness.
Exactly, and people waking up. I mean, we are waking up to a much grander universe, both internally and externally. It's a parallel. The dimensions that we're encountering in the phenomenal discoveries of astronomy right now are paralleled by the exploration of the inner world. And that's another difference between the East and the West. The East took time to explore the inner world, and the West took time to explore the outer world. So I'll tell you about the Awakening Arts Network, because it was born out of a show that I curated, actually, at the Sonoma Museum of Visual Art in Santa Rosa. And it was called Ancient and Contemporary Expressions of Sacred Art. And when I put the title or call to artists out, I made it really specific. Like, if you feel that your life work is doing this kind of sacred art, you know, let us know. And it ended up bringing in hundreds of requests to be in the show. And we had like 40 spaces, so it was phenomenal. There was literally over 1,000 artists who applied to be in this show. And so I was like, where are these artists? You never see them. Where are their venues? And then I realized they don't have venues. In fact, that show, which was very popularly received with great joy, from the janitors to the people who walked through, everybody loved it. But it was controversial with the board of directors at the museum. It's like, you know, I don't know. What does this have to do with modern art? Because modern art has an unspoken canon that it can't be spiritual. You can have something that is historically spiritual, like, the Tibetan mandalas from 1942. You can have really in-the-face critique of spiritual. You can have piss Christ, and that's fine, you know, something where it's really a sharp edge against it. But if you go, this piece is my authentic experience of the divine, it's like, you know, it's just not in the canon of the high-end gallery scene or the museums or whatever. So we're in a time of transition, but that's in all of the areas. Same with business, same with economics.
That's when you get to the end of a paradigm, and there's always folks at the edge. I mean, that was a show that was pushing the edge.
Yeah.
I want to shift gears entirely. I'm going to take it back to you for a bit here. Because there are people who think about the arts and visual art in particular and say, oh, I am not an artist.
Mm-hmm.
I can't draw, but I really want to know, I'm really curious, how do you work, what goes on in your mind, you know, not just the form, mm-hmm. you know, or I see a form like this and say, how did you, I mean, how, you know. So I want to show folks a video with you doing your work.
Okay.
So that we can walk with you and sort of stand in your shoes for a bit.
Okay.
So we can get that started. And in the meantime, what I want to know is, what paints you're working with? Here we go.
Okay. There they are. Beautiful.
When I start a painting, I always begin with a period of prayer, often meditation and centering. Because what I'm striving to do is to connect with the deepest, inmost part of myself, to have the creativity come from that font within, the fountain of divine creativity. It's interesting because I think in our culture we tend to think of creativity as something that you need in order to do art. And I really feel that the reverse is true, that in fact what art is a vehicle for helping us connect with our creativity, and creativity is vast and huge and necessary for everything that we do, from raising children to running a business to addressing the incredibly important and urgent problems of our day. We can't think in old ways. We can't behave out of habit and pattern and ways of being and thinking that repeat and are redundant and come from what we already know. We have to tap into a bigger territory, a more vast and expansive understanding of ourselves and the world. And in order to do that, we have to be creative. That's what creativity is. It's coming from the future, in a sense. It's drawing from what is not yet known. And art helps us to tap creativity, and that's its purpose. And so everyone would benefit from doing art, not just people who can make pretty pictures, not just people who can copy well. When we allow ourselves to paint or to dance or to sing or to do any of the modalities of the arts, it begins to open that aperture inside of us. It opens the channel so that creativity can begin to flow. And once it flows, then energy can be applied in any direction. The creative flow is like a moving stream inside of us, and it needs to be awakened or tapped or channeled.
Ready? Uh-huh. You should get. Well, I guess we're getting it. Oh, I love that so much.
I think the idea that there's an elite group of people who are artists and is very unfortunate, because it means that we assign this minority, this small group of people, the task of experiencing our feelings for us, processing our emotions for us, having the deep and expressive response to life for us. They're singing our songs, they're painting our paintings. It's like that work is human nature. It's human nature to express the insides, to press forth the inside to the outside, which is what expression means. And it's robbed when we have this idea that there's a small group of people and they're the ones that are supposed to do art or do creativity. It's for all of us, and especially in this time period when the world is in peril, we all have to open that channel and allow ourselves to be artists and creators. And that's what I hope to be, is a channel for that divine force, that creativity that is the same creativity that created the universes, the stars, the galaxies, all life as we know it, the creativity of God.
Dana, that looks like just too much fun.
It is. It turns out that actual bliss experiences are good for us. We need it.
Oh, I just had that sense of standing there with the canvas. I mean, probably what you teach in your classes at the academy.
Yes.
You know, these kids got to have too. I mean, this is like finger painting. For, you know, it's divine.
No, absolutely. And that's exactly what I do teach, is that inspiration, that joy, that just sheer childlike 4-year-old delight of connection with the soul pouring forth without any hesitation, unabashed.
No censor, no teacher, no ruler on your fingers.
That is healing in a profound way. And it begins the flow of intuition from within. It helps us connect to our inner world, so we begin to tap into the guidance and the wisdom of ourselves.
So we're seeing here. Tell us who these students are.
Well, this is the Academy of Art, Creativity, and Consciousness, which is in Italy, and it's through Ananda, which is a yoga retreat center that has people coming from all of the world, particularly Europe. So we have students from Croatia, from England, from France, Germany, everywhere. And it's a summer program that we have, where we have all different kinds of classes helping people to tap into that place. And then also some with themes that go deeper, like working with the chakras and working with yoga and different deeper teachings, but using the arts as a vehicle. And so the Awakening Arts Network is part of that as well, because it's a nexus for the artists who are doing this kind of work to come together, to meet, to feed from each other, and to also know that there are these other connections of people working in the same place.
We're thrilled and privileged to be able to have you opening, you know, creating that wedge for us in this last minute, 2 minutes here, as we watch some of the last of your work, Zeitgeist, about the spirit of the times, part of your reflection of the spirit of the times, the wonderful magic in the chaos. Can you tell us what it is that inspires you the most?
Well,
in what you're doing here.
Yeah, I see we're still looking at these pictures of the classes, and I think what inspires me in other people's work, just as in my own, is just the fact that there's an aperture that widens inside of us, and that when that aperture opens and widens, through creativity, through the arts, it's actually a profoundly spiritual possibility, because that opens the channel where we become conduits of heaven and earth, the conduits of divine energy. And rather than being that ego-driven personality on the surface that's trying to get ahead and win and beat other people and, you know, kind of make the finish line first and all of these kinds of things, you move to a much deeper identity. And you begin to experience yourself as a channel and a vehicle for the infinite and for the divine. And then you become much more centered in the soul. And that shift, you know, so it's childlike joy and it's wonderment. But in fact, it actually opens the door for something extremely profound. And I see, teaching it over the years, that over and over again, people go through tremendous transformations in a short period of time. And they'll make changes that the mind couldn't have done. You can go to therapy for 40 years and understand your problems completely and not be able to change them. But if you work with the creativity and the energy, you're actually able to shift in miraculously easy and fruitful and effortless ways, because you're addressing something that's actually at the core.
It feels to me, as I looked at the images with people and all of that rich color, first of all, I mean, just having the color has got to be healing.
It is.
Alone.
It actually is. Just moving color around is very healing. And even just doing things like brush strokes and circles and spirals. I mean, first of all, circling and spiraling are the archetypes of creation.
Yes.
I mean, water, cascades and spirals, and the wind and the air whirls and twirls, fire dances with curves and spirals. It's like the spirals in galaxies, the nebulae, the DNA. It's as if the etheric template of creation is circling and spiraling, and then depending on the element, it takes form in different ways. So when I do the classes, it's much more than painting. We do movement, we do music, we do theater, we do all of the arts are included in the academy, and many other teachers. Even just moving your body and painting in circles is reconnecting us, recalibrating us in a sense to our core.
What I hear in that is you bypass the mind by and large, and by getting into our bodies with that color, with that movement, and sort of taking the voices out that say you can't do that, the critics that say that. You're tapping something that's got to be, how do I say it? It sure is contrary to sort of the Western business, results oriented, productivity oriented, Puritan ethic kind of work hard.
Yes,
I mean a real counter to that.
It is. It's another world. And it's something that we're growing into as a culture. I mean, we're leaving behind a left-brain-dominant society where if you excelled in linear sequential, you would have your good job as an accountant or a lawyer or doctor. All of these types of jobs are being outsourced either to software or to third-world countries that can do it cheaper. So what is the new skill that's emerging? It's people who can orchestrate, who can see the whole picture, who can be creative, who can be collaborative, who can work with imaginative intelligence, narrative intelligence, all these other ways of thinking and knowing and being. It's like we've been in this little straitjacket of, like, I get the image right now of the man's suit with the little noose necktie, It's like there's been a straitjacket on the human being, and that is changing. We're becoming a colored, full-spectrum human being that is able to understand and experience reality on many more levels.
Going back to what you were saying about your early beginnings, thinking of being an environmentalist and activist, it seems to me that the work you're doing that opens you and others to those other levels of intelligence, mm-hmm. and actually to be co-creators, I mean, to be participants in co-creating, it also feels to me like with the spirals, they're reconnecting with nature.
Yes.
Which has been lost a lot. Yeah. That maybe we need that shift in order to meet the really big problems that we are facing, because we're not
exactly
meeting
it.
Them on with no. the old level of
That is exactly
thinking.
It. Because everything that we're trained to, it's like we've been educated for a world that existed in 1915 or something, the factory model and the ability to be compliant and all of these things. And the world has shifted fundamentally to a place where what is actually coming to bear is coming from the future almost. We don't have any idea what next week or next year is going to be like. So we have to move into super conscious modes of being, not subconscious that comes from this is the way we've always done it, this is the way my grandparents did it, or the conscious mind that's feverishly trying to figure it out, get all the ducks in the row and perfect everything and make it perfect. The super conscious draws from inspiration, intuition, and is open to what has not yet existed, which is what the arts train people.
That's what
the arts cultivate us into a state of mind where we are absolutely open to what has yet to exist, because it's always pouring forth towards us from the as yet to be future. Art doesn't come from the past. That's reproductive mode. That's representing what existed already. So I think it's quite fundamental.
You've got an exhibition that you were part of called Zeitgeist, which means Spirit of the Times. I'd love to see that, because that seems to me one edge that you tell us a little bit about it. Because that's quite an interesting word and an interesting idea.
It's actually one of my favorite words. It's a German word, and it means the spirit of the times. But in the sense of the fact that whenever there are great changes in culture and society and consciousness, it's as if it happens everywhere at once. The arts begin to change, the business begins to change, the healthcare begins to change. And the zeitgeist is like this pulse that happens throughout the world all at one time. And so I actually have a particular painting called Zeitgeist that was the sort of centerpiece of that exhibit. And Zeitgeist has on the surface of it, at the top, there's like these rolling, roiling, chaotic things happening, volcanoes, tsunamis, And the things that are happening in our world, hurricanes, worlds falling apart, glaciers melting, all of this chaos that's happening on the surface. But underneath that painting, as you dive down, you begin to see the roots that are beginning to connect us. So for instance, fiber optic cables, literally sutures of light, are moving underneath the waters, connecting continent to continent. That's why we can email somebody in Japan, because a thread of light is under the surface of the water, pulsing light from country to country. And so underneath these chaotic changes on the surface, there are incredibly powerful unitive elements going on. And so in this painting, you can also see pictures of the Earth from space, another thing that only in the last few decades have we been able to see ourselves whole. A planet, a blue pearl with a thin blue line, a precious oneness. And we can see the land and the seas from above, and we can realize, where are the fences? Where are the boundaries? Mm-hmm. And so we are really in a, that to me is the zeitgeist of our time. The zeitgeist is that we have a frothy surface of chaos where everything is falling apart and erupting. And underneath, very deep threads of unity weaving and beginning to move into these other levels of unity. So it's like, that's the interesting thing, you know, it's like it's both are happening at once. We're more unified, more connected than ever before, and we're also in a time of great chaos and disintegration. And so the painting showed that, and then in the exhibit that I had, this was at the Institute of Noetic Sciences, which is a perfect example of this, because this was founded by Apollo 14 astronaut Edgar Mitchell, and he was coming back from the Apollo 14 mission, and he saw the Earth from a distance in space, and he saw this precious blue pearl, and he had a mystical experience. He had a profound sense of the underlying unity of all things. And it was very poignant for him, and he thought, how is it that our science doesn't even touch this? And so the Institute of Noetic Sciences sponsors research that really looks into consciousness, to healing, to
and
the power of
noetic
mind.
Means.
That's what noetic means.
Consciousness.
It means
yes.
the larger consciousness, the larger intelligence, as opposed to like rational or other types. And so this exhibit was there, and it was a good example of the Awakening Arts Network, because I was joined with two other sculptors, and we co-created and brought our works together. So in there you're seeing Ginger Gilmore's beautiful Contemplation, that's the name of that piece, with Gaia, the painting behind it. And that came alive. We also did a performance piece as well. So it was really all the modalities. And there's an incredible synergy that happens when artists begin to come together, when they're creating from their source. And that's an example of that miracle. Because if we're on the edge creating from or generating our lives, our personalities, and what we're up to from this edge of ourselves that's trying to be something and be special and, you know, the persona in a sense, we have an entirely different world that we co-create than if we come to the center. If you're from your center and I'm from my center and we're generative from that font within, then when we connect, when we interplay, we create something so beautiful.
And something beyond the individuals.
Absolutely.
I mean, there's a synergy. It's having tasted that, there are moments when you feel as if something is being created and you get to be lucky enough to be a participant or a witness to.
No, that's exactly right. There's something much bigger than the individual. There's like the, you know, there's the collective intelligence, which I think is something that springs to life in there. And there's also the divine intelligence, the intelligence that created all worlds. And those are what flow when we go to the center. Both. We connect in a far more profound way. And so to me, that's why it really does tie back into the urgent problems of our world. Because we cannot solve those problems from our little bitty rational mind at the edge of ourselves with our personas battling it out. We can't. We're out of time. Maybe we could have, but now we're out of time. We have to go to the place that can generate super conscious solutions that come from places that don't yet exist and that come from places that are deep inside of us, that have the same font of energy and vibrancy that was there when the stars were made. And when we tap that, then we start having solutions like that. I think of something, you think of something, we generate. Doesn't matter whose idea it is. We don't take time for that. Who cares? Like, okay, that's a good idea. Does it work? Okay, let's go with it. Rather than my position and your position, my platform, your platform. That's a battling out that we don't have time for anymore. Look what's happening in Congress. Look what's happening in politics. That mode of being and where you have your little set of ideas that you're defending against another set of ideas, that time is gone. We have to move with energy and consciousness that flows fresh into new forms in every moment, and none of us have ownership. We just play it. We connect and we play it. We play the opening connection to the divine, and we play with each other. And then we're in the Garden of Eden.
Which, with all those colors and beautiful paints, sounds a whole lot more fun than the mess that we've made here.
Yeah, exactly.
It seems to me, as you talked, I was thinking about the deadlock in Congress, for example,
right.
that adversarial approach, which we see all over the planet in the main institutions that are denying climate change, whatever.
Right, exactly.
We need almost new beings, certainly transformed beings.
Yes, no,
to
absolutely.
To be able to meet headlong. I mean, we're sort of being forced back, into coming at this from an entirely different place. And it feels to me like many of those that are in leadership aren't our leaders, the true leaders. Where will they come from?
Well, I think it's actually a shift and a part of the overall shift in terms of the font, where the font is. Like, in the past, whatever, period of time, the font of world culture was New York City, for instance. You know, the idea that there was one place that sort of disseminated it for the rest. And I think we're in a time when there are multiple fonts of leadership, of inspiration. It's really the co-creative time. Thich Nhat Hanh says the second coming of Christ will be a community. You know, and Yogananda and Swami Kriyananda have advocated world brotherhood colonies, and I've lived in one for many years. Mm-hmm. My own spiritual life, fed by Ananda and by yoga, is very powerful and important to me. But it's that sense of the community that comes to bear, and that is a different model than the individual against the individual.
Yes. It seems to me that you know, that model of sort of individuals very separated, sort of battling, egos battling out, you need that totally inverted. So you're living in community for
most of my life.
Has fed this work, your work, you.
Absolutely.
And your change of worldview.
Absolutely. Because I think, you know, if you were to visit an Ananda community, and there's many other types of communities, you would see the new civilization in the making. You would experience people who are behaving as new beings, partly because they're coming from being. Like, we come from, you know, our culture comes from frenetic doing. And when you do come to the center, you come from being, and then you have an interaction. You know, we have meetings where we sit down to address a major problem, and the question is not, well, I think this or I think that or here's what we should do. People sort of sit back, put out the facts and the perspectives, and then say, what's trying to happen? What's trying to happen? And that simple question is an entirely different approach. What is it that, given all the things that are going on in your perspective and my perspective, what is trying to come forth? And then you become a witness to it, a cultivation of it, and a receiving of something that is greater, like you said before, greater than any individual. It opens the invitation to the collective, and it also opens the invitation to the divine.
You know, the image that I have here is that since Darwin, you know, putting humans at the top of the pyramid of evolution, we sort of have thought we're the end of evolution, right? We're at the apex, you know, we're it. But what you're describing feels to me like a next phase, and that
you in your
collective intelligence and your community are sort of cells or organs in a new being. I mean, it's a loss for words, which is, of course, a good signal.
Like the butterfly, you know, that dissolves the old form inside the cocoon, and then little imaginal cells, little imaginal cells begin to constellate a new creature, a new being, an entirely different being. And that's what I think you and I and many other people are serving right now, is imaginal cells. They're not quite... They're swimming around in a world that isn't tied to the old world, and the new world doesn't quite exist yet. But as we each bring forth with courage, confidence, passion, joy, humility, who we are and what we're meant to be doing in this world, our dharma and our giving, our gift to the world,
yes.
then these different imaginal cells begin to connect, and we begin to constellate an entirely new reality. And that's the invitation of this time. That's the zeitgeist.
The invitation of the time. Going back to your image there of the caterpillar, and that it all of it dissolves. That's the thing that's amazing. You have to allow for total blobby destruction.
Yes.
For those imaginal cells that get awakened, which have some sense of what's to emerge, which in this case is the butterfly.
That's exactly right.
That's a scary thing to go through. I mean, it's death, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I think that that's a big part of what, I mean, people can say, oh, this sounds wonderful, but I'm going through a whole lot of falling apart in my
yes.
life. And to see it as part of that
larger
shaping
process
into creation.
Oh, that's exactly right. And that's also where creative process can be so valuable, because art and creativity is also always healing. It's such a fantastic ongoing therapy, because when you do artistic or creative processes of any sort, music, painting, drawing, whatever it is, sculpting, you begin to work with directly the energies that are going on for you, and you begin to transmute them. It's an alchemical process. It allows you, like when you move the clay, or when you move the paint, or when you dance, you're embodying the internal emotional processes. And in the process of embodying it, you work it through. You move it to the next level. You transmute it. I mean, we can express emotions, project them, or we can interject them, and the arts actually allow for a third option, which is we can alchemically transmute them. We express them, but they are allowed to move into new forms.
I read recently someone's quote that emotion comes from E and motion.
Right, energy and motion.
and that if we sit on them, or, you know, which our culture says, no, anger is not okay, joy,
right.
you know, and joy is not okay, really.
Right, no, exactly, that's right.
Is that just letting that energy move is a huge part, I'm sure, of our healing.
But it's different than just projecting it, which is like, you know, either freezing it or throwing it out. Because when you let it express, you're also coming from being a channel and an instrument, so that the intelligence of energy can move itself. It's sort of like what's trying to happen. I think that phrase, there's an understanding that's emerging across the board that energy has an intelligence of its own. There's an inherent intelligence in energy. And if you will allow it to move through you and not try to control it, but also serve as an instrument for it, like the Holy Grail, you create a strong and steady chalice that is built of your own individuation and your own form and who you are, but you open at the heart and you open to the wider realities. So I think the Holy Grail is actually an archetype of the human being in a posture and a mudra of openness to the divine, rooted in the self and expanding to a larger reality.
You know, as you speak, some of the terms, of course, come to us from the Hindu, from the yoga as well. And I realize that for some people it will sound foreign. But the notion of letting the energy move through, I have a sense that more people have a sense of the sacred than will admit it, maybe, in this culture.
Yeah.
Do you find that in the academy, in the classes?
Oh, absolutely. I think it's a question of new wineskins. Like, you know, basically we've got people tapping into a living reality of the sacred, and the old forms are not good wineskins for that. We have to find new forms and ways in which we've been doing anything, but also clearly in religion, are just not going to serve us as we evolve into the future. And it's not that we cast them aside, because truth is eternal. It just, it's that it's a perennial, living, organic thing that gives new forms every time it sprouts forth across cultures and time periods. And so it's not a question of like the postmodern viewpoint, which is saying all of it's relevant, relative, and that it doesn't matter what your perspective is and it's all the same. You end up with this flatland postmodern soup where there is no valuation. That's not it at all. It's really the understanding that there's a multiple dimensional reality, and that the truth comes out of that, because the truth is a living thing. It's not an ideational thing. It's a living reality.
You know, if you think about, I think about art history books or, you know, classical music or whatever, it's like we sort of crystallize some of those forms and don't realize that as they were emerging, they were just as troubling to, you know, people used to seeing the previous set of images.
Yes, that's true.
Right?
That's a great example.
When Da Vinci and the Renaissance brought us perspective view, or Rembrandt got us foreshortening mm-hmm. on the body, it's like,
what are they doing?
We lose the orientation we're familiar with.
Yes, no, that's true.
And it seems to me that what your work is doing is inviting people to step up to being co-creators.
Yes.
With a universe.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not the same as having a priest mediate for you,
mm-hmm.
or the divine mm-hmm. is separate from me.
Mm-hmm.
The notion that I'm part of the creation, you know, it's like it's a big challenge to how we think of who we are.
Mm-hmm.
How we think who we are.
Yeah, I think it's back to that butterfly. All kinds of fundamental things about who we are and what the world is are dissolving.
Yeah.
But it's trusting and cultivating the capacity to have trust and also intuitive connection, intuition. And that's, again, back to that theme of the source. When we go to our own center, we have a flow of intuition. We have a sense about, and it's very practical. It doesn't have to be mystical or, you know, have big terms. It's like, I have a sensibility about what feels like the right next step for me. And I may not see the whole, you know, next decade ahead, mm-hmm. but I have mm-hmm. a real strong sensibility about what's right and what's the next unfoldment for me. And when we begin to live from that place of faith and trust and co-creativity with the divine, then it does make the whole process easier, because then the dissolving of the form can be ecstatic, not just painful and troublesome.
Yes. I think if you are letting yourself be comfortable with the whole process, I mean, that's what I hear the invitation here.
Yes.
Is to say, I'm a little uncomfortable because there's nothing left, but time and experience, you trust that something will emerge.
Yes, and creativity is radical training for that. Creativity, you know, is way bigger than art. You know, art, the arts help us to activate creativity, and creativity is what allows us to practice the skill of sure. being trusting in the flow, of being open to the unknown, of tapping into a deeper and higher source.
I feel like, well, I'm ready to head over to Italy and have fun with the finger paints.
That sounds good.
That sounds good. Well, but you are teaching elsewhere.
Yes.
You teach what kinds of things are you teaching? Not so
well,
where,
but yeah, where? I'm on a 6-month tour at the moment, mm-hmm. teaching tour. So I'm teaching in Palo Alto at the East West Bookstore, and then also Portland New Renaissance Bookstore, Seattle East West Bookstore. I'm doing a workshop with a colleague in Seattle also. Mm-hmm. And then a wonderful workshop at the end of the year at the Institute of Noetic Sciences, where we're, it's a New Year's time, so we're going to be using art and creativity to explore mm-hmm. and release the past and to generate and create the future, creating a collage vision board and some other wonderful embodied exercises, and then a Hawaii, 9 days in Hawaii,
wow.
where we're swimming with the dolphins, painting on the beach, making masks, taking them to the volcano, some very powerful creative processes with a good dose of adventure and relaxation.
And being there with Pele and the, I mean, talk about the generative forces there.
Exactly.
So the sounds like it's not, you're not, you're doing different things in different places.
Yes.
Is that
mm-hmm.
is that right? Mm-hmm. Helping people with the creative process.
Yes. And then I'll be back to Italy in the spring.
Such a life. Such a life. So in our last, 3 minutes here,
okay.
What haven't we covered? It's still sitting there burning that says you want people to hear.
Well, I think that each one of us has a responsibility to be brave and courageous in these times. Mm. And that's going to mean different things for different people. But it's like stepping up to the plate, because we all are being called, and we hear it and we know it. And we know what that is. And so we just have to, I think, take brave steps, whatever those are, for ourselves. And also to recognize that we're not alone, and we're not just these little personalities. We are immortal beings, and we are infinite. We are much huger. The part that we normally occupy, this little self, is such a tiny tip of the iceberg of who we are. And so if we can release the grip of that a little bit, loosen up our grasp so hard of this small, narrow self, and relax into a reality that's bigger, into a connectivity that's more profound, even in just the littlest ways, I think it's very important in our times, and that none of us are on a free ride right now. We have to all show up for this.
I think that the planet is, we're in unprecedented times.
Absolutely.
For this planet, and certainly since humans have been on it. And when you talk about people showing up, to do, to hear, to listen, which is a lot of learning and a lot of stretching, you give me hope.
Well, thank you.
You give me hope.
That's. I feel honored, and that would be a true goal for me.
Your
inspirational arts.
I like it. Well, that's what you're doing. That's what you've been doing. That's what you're helping other people to do. So it's not just yours. I love that image.
No, not like, at all.
Your academy is planting seeds along with the crabgrass?
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Is that right?
Dandelion seeds.
I hope that, I hope a lot of people can tap what you're doing in their own ways, you know, because you encourage me to think this is a planetary.
It's a movement, and it is a planetary phenomenon. Absolutely.
A lot of people awakening.
Awakening arts.
That's right. Yeah. That's the network that you are.
Yeah, and it's also the art of awakening. Okay.
Dana, thank you. This
thank
has been
you so
wonderful.
Much.
Wonderful. Thank you for joining us. The Outside Edge with Dana Lynn Anderson, who's doing the edge to the source. And I think you're also doing the source to the edge.
Yeah. Thank you so much.
Thank you for joining us.
Oh, love returns. All arising and dissolving in eternal dance. In eternal. Only one life.